My name is Susan Verberg and I am an independent researcher specializing in medieval brewing, and in this poster I will look beyond the botanicals ordinarily associated with the medieval beer gruit. The gruit paste is made by mashing coarsely ground malt with hot water to make sugary wort, and the wort is heated over fire to concentrate the sugars into a paste. This poster looks at two options to create the gruit base. Version 1 includes both the wort and spent grains. Version 2 is filtered to create a malt extract like syrup. Both versions, as well as one without any paste, will include those preserving herbs most associated with medieval gruit. Some questions to look at. Was the gruit base similar to modern malt extract, or was it more like a porridge? Would this paste significantly affect fermentation and thus alcohol content? Is there a difference between using this substance with the herbs or to just use the herbs as is custom in modern gruit ales? And what was going on with the resin? As the recipes do not mention whether the spent grain is removed after mashing, I opted to make it both ways. The porridge needs no filtering but needs extra care not to burn. The syrup needs to be filtered, but then concentrating is fairly straightforward. Concentrating wort is still done today. Cans of malt extract can be diluted for instant beer wort, and small cans of yeast nutrient-rich malt extract are available to help proof yeast quickly. And here I'm adding gruit herbs to the concentrating wort. This step would be familiar to those making maple syrup at home, the concentrating. And for this experiment, I prepared 4 half-gallon samples. One sample received the herbed porridge, one the herbed syrup, one is left plain, and the other received the specific mixture of herbs as found in the historic sources. The herbs found are bog myrtle, laurel berries, laserwort, and pine resin. But as laserwort is not commercially available, I substituted it with the similar caraway. Hot wort is added to each sample, diluting the gruit pastes and infusing the herbal additives. The two gruit bases are based on post-period recipes from the 16th and early 19th century. The original or starting gravity is measured of each sample before the yeast is added. I use a brewing hydrometer to read the amount of sugar in solution, which, combined with the final reading, makes it possible to calculate the percentage of alcohol generated by the yeast. I had intended to use farmhouse kveik yeast for this experiment, as that type of yeast is most likely to be similar to the medieval yeast strains. But our wood-heated house was too cold for the kveik to show activity that day, so I defaulted to the other medieval option, to bread yeast. I prefer to use kveik as it ferments fast, leaves more time for the brew to be consumed before souring, which would be a welcome advantage. The gruit paste significantly affected fermentation, and especially the porridge resulted in a much higher alcohol by volume. The plain wort soured within 2 wintry weeks, the herbed wort took a bit longer, and the 2 gruit paste versions are still going strong. The porridge gruit worked better in this experiment, but it's unclear if that is due to the use of chaff or to the unexpected effect of resin. The resin was added hot to hot substrate, and this change in process seemed to have significantly boosted both its flavor and also the preservative function. The gruit paste boosted the alcohol by volume percentage nicely, and the porridge worked much better as expected, but the difference in application of the resin interfered, and it's unclear whether the paste or the resin alone is responsible for the noticeably of the beer. This proof of concept experiment shows that there is validity to the use of gruit paste and of resin in the brewing of gruit beer, and I hope to inspire others with the means to look at the process in more detail in the future. Thank you.